Good evening. I'm President Johnson from the Southern District of the Lutheran Church Missouri Synod, and I'm here to welcome you to our Friday night prayer vigil. This is something we've been doing almost every Friday night since the COVID crisis began, and it's something that we're going to continue to do, but tonight is our last regular weekly Friday prayer vigil. We're going to go to a different format. We're working on that right now, and you'll be aware, and it'll be announced as to what we're doing and the changes in the format. But we're going to be still coming to you and still be leading in prayer. And so tonight we have Pastor Bernie Huseman from Grace Lutheran Church in Pensacola, Florida. Bernie is a friend and a colleague, and I'm excited to have him lead us tonight in our prayer vigil. And so just welcome Bernie. And before we get there, I want to talk to you just a little bit about what's going on in our world. Right now, anxiety is really high. People are anxious about the COVID thing. People are anxious about, you know, their churches opening or not opening, whether they're going to go to church or not go to church. People are anxiety is very high about the racial tension that's going on and other political, economic, and social issues that are happening in our world. And when anxiety is high, it causes fear. And we as Christians, we don't have to act in fear because we know our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ calls to us and says, "Fear not." Over and over and over again in Scripture, the Lord speaks these words to his people, "Fear not, for I am with you." Jesus says that he is with us always to the very end of the age. And so we don't have to act in fear. You don't have to act in fear, towards your neighbor. You don't have to act in fear towards your pastor or towards leadership in the church. You don't have to act in fear towards other people because we know that our lives rest in the hand of our Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus tells us that those who are in his hand are in the Father's hand, and that the Father won't lose any of us, but that Jesus will raise us all up on the last day. And so think about this, that you don't have to act in anxiety. You don't have to act in fear. You don't have to act in anger, but you can act as people of grace, because God has given to us his word of grace in his Son, Jesus Christ. So would you pray with me this evening? Father God, we just ask you that you would come and grant us the peace that passes all understanding. Calm our fears that we might be able to be ministers to our neighbors who are in fear. And Lord, we fear not because you are with us. We fear not because the Holy Spirit resides in us through our baptism. And so, Lord, we just look to you. And we ask you, O God, calm our fears, remove our anxieties because you care for us, and then allow us to be able to be your people of peace and grace and mercy towards those around us. We ask you to give us these gifts that you give through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen and amen. And now, I'm going to turn you over to my friend, Pastor Bernie, and he will lead us in the rest of the way in this prayer vigil. The Lord's blessings be upon you. Good night. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Pastor Bernie Huseman from Grace Lutheran Church in Pensacola, Florida. I'm honored to be happy to be with you for this prayer time. And there is no better time in the world to pray than right now. So we've heard from President Johnson. Let's take a few minutes now and go right into prayer. And then I want to share some scripture and some thoughts with you as we do this here today. So would you join me in prayer, please? Heavenly Father, we give you great thanksgiving and praise for who you are. You alone are the eternal God of the universe. You alone are the true God. You are Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We come to you, Lord, because you are the only one to come to and because you've invited us to. We are so thankful and we are so grateful, Lord, for your love, for your mercy, and for your grace poured out upon all mankind, shown most clearly and especially in the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Lord, we come to you in his name. Our hearts, Lord, are heavy. Our lives have been burdened, as many of us have, perhaps have not been burdened before. And Lord, in these days that provide much confusion and where there's all kinds of not just information, but misinformation about the situation with COVID-19, and its treatment and who should get it and who is not going to get it and masks and no masks and freedoms and opening and closing and all of those things, Lord, we come to you seeking help, seeking refuge, seeking your peace. We thank you in advance for hearing our prayers and for answering them. Lord, not because of anything that we are, but because of your invitation to pray and because of your promises in your holy word. Lord, we start off just by pouring our hearts out to you regarding COVID-19. This whole coronavirus issue, Lord, has taken every person in the world to places that we haven't been before. There's virtually no one alive who has experienced anything like this on this scale before. And so every day, every hour of every day, it seems, is new and uncharted ground and uncharted territory. Sometimes we don't know how best to handle it. Sometimes we're tempted to listen to the voice of the enemy, who would love nothing more than for us to be fearful, to be afraid, to take our eyes off of you and of your word and cast us into all kinds of doubts and fears and even depression about the whole thing. Isolation, Lord, like we've been isolated and many places are re-isolating once again, is hard on us because you've created us, even the most introverted person, you've created us to be social beings. We thrive on relationships, especially our relationship with you. So Lord, while we are apart from one another and we can't hug and shake hands and worship together as we could just a few short months ago, we do nonetheless realize that this is also an opportunity for us to grow closer to you. Lord, many people have a little bit more time on their hands since they're not able to go out and do some of the social things that we once did. And so it gives us more time to be in your word. It gives us more time to pray. It gives us more time to seek and to listen to your Holy Spirit and to receive from you, Lord, your mercy and your grace found in your word. Lord, we pray that you'd have mercy on this world. Many have died. Many are suffering. There is much fear, Lord, as it seems every day. We learn of more people that are in our own circles who have been diagnosed positive for COVID-19. We thank you, Lord, for those who are diagnosed positive and have no symptoms. They're completely asymptomatic, and we pray your healing hand would be upon them and that you would restore them to health quickly in your will. We pray also for those who have symptoms and who suffer from this virus. You are the great physician, Heavenly Father. And so we pour out our hearts to you and intercede on behalf of those who are suffering with coronavirus. They have it. Their families can't contact them, nor they their families. It's even more isolated. And Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus that you would have mercy on these individuals and that you would bring health and healing to their bodies according to your will. We pray, Lord God, for the doctors and the scientists and the laboratories that are working very, very hard to try to come up with solutions and answers to treat not only the symptoms, but ultimately, Father, to provide a vaccine for this virus. And we pray that you would grant them success. We pray that you would give them wisdom that is beyond themselves, Lord, and beyond their schooling, beyond their training. We pray, Lord God, that there would be breakthroughs and insights given so that the population of the world will not have to suffer with coronavirus anymore. Lord, let this pass from us, if it be your will. Lord, we pray for our country, and things seem to be ramping up in some areas, Lord, once again. It could be the continuation of just really the first wave in some areas. It might be a second wave in other areas. We simply do not know. And so we hold our hands up, Lord, in surrender to you because you do know. And so we ask, Lord, that you would slow the spread of this virus. We ask that you'd give us wisdom to know how best to social distance, how best to wear masks, how best to care for one another, and how best to be loving and understanding and empathetic toward those who have differing opinions. Lord, if there's anybody in our country that's trying to cause the country or the people of this country harm due to manipulation, we pray that you'd stop them. We pray for anybody who's trying to be dishonest with this virus. Lord, we hear different things about people falsifying numbers and falsifying counts and falsifying tests. We don't know if the tests were faulty to begin with or if there's shenanigans that are going on behind the scenes. But Lord, if there, we just pray that you would stop all of that stuff. Lord, we ask that if anyone is trying to use this for political manipulation in this election year, that you would just frustrate the efforts of those people and that you would give the people of this country wisdom and eyes to see through any schemes that might be going on. It's bad enough that the coronavirus is here, Lord, and so we pray that you would allow no one to use it for political manipulation. We pray that you would allow no one to use it for any kind of devious or ill-fated purpose of any kind. And we know, Lord, that you can and you will stop those people and that they are accountable to you. Lord, we especially lift up the states of the Southern District, Florida, Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana. Lord, all of these places have seen increases, especially, Lord, Florida. Louisiana has been hard hit, Lord, and is hard hit again. In Florida, Lord, as you know, we keep setting records on how many people are diagnosed positive, but we don't know if we can even trust those numbers because of the misinformation and false information that is out there. But you do know, Lord. And so we turn our eyes away from the numbers and we focus them on you, Heavenly Father, Lord Jesus, Holy Spirit. Keep our eyes on the cross. Keep our eyes on your word and keep our eyes on our neighbor that we can help them in whatever they need. Be that just a kind and courteous word. Be that an encouraging conversation. Be that running to the grocery store for them because they're fearful. Whatever, Lord, help us to be the body of Christ. Help us to be the church. We don't need the walls of a church building to be the church, Lord. In fact, sometimes that gets in the way. So, Lord, empower us with your Holy Spirit to reach out, to not be fearful, and to love as Jesus would love. Lord, the world is kind of treating this almost kind of as a leprosy was treated when you walked the earth, Jesus, and nobody wanted to be around someone who had that. And it's the same kind of a thing now with COVID. And Lord, we pray that you'd give us the strength and the power of your Holy Spirit to be able to do what you did, Jesus, and to walk in there and not to be afraid. Give us protection. Lord, there's many places in your word where you promise to protect the righteous. None of us claims righteousness on our own, but because of the shed blood of Christ that we are clothed in, and in the baptismal grace that we are clothed in, and with the righteousness of Christ that comes because of our baptism, we pray that these promises, and we claim these promises, that you will give protection to your people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray especially, Lord, for our Southern District congregations, big and small. Lord, we're affected, every last one of us, a little bit differently than the other ones, because what works in some places doesn't work in other places, and what works in a larger church doesn't work in a smaller church, and vice versa. And so we pray for every last congregation of our Southern District, that you would raise up leaders who have wisdom. We pray that you would give pastors wisdom and knowledge and skill to be able to lead the congregations of our district through this period of difficulty, that we can come out on the other side more effective at discipling others, more effective at bringing Christ to the lost and to those who don't yet know him. Lord, let us break out of the walls of our sanctuaries, of our worship centers, and bring the gospel to bear 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year into the communities in which you have called us to live. Help us to live life on mission. And if it takes COVID to light that fire underneath us, Lord, to get us to see that our mission and ministry is out there, as it were, where the people are, then so be it. But bring about great, great joy and great, great strength in your church through what is going on with this virus. Thank you for the work that you're doing in congregations. Lord, if there are congregations like ours that are awaiting back-ordered equipment so that we can better serve the online community and do live streaming better than we already do, we pray that that equipment would arrive soon. And we pray that all the technology would work well and that people would be able to figure out all the little glitches and technical issues that come from that. And we pray, Lord, that the seeds of your word and of the gospel that are planted in online situations in these congregations, in our congregations, that they would bear fruit, much fruit for the kingdom. Lord, we don't know when we put our services out online for the general public. We just have no idea who's going to watch those. But you do. And so we pray that you'd lead people, especially those people who don't know you or whose faith is weak, wherever they are in the world, to be able to find our online and streaming services and Bible studies, that they might grow closer to you. And if it's your will, Lord, let us establish connections with those people and ongoing relationships so that discipleship can happen and more can know Jesus. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we pray for our country, for things besides COVID-19. There is gross injustice, and there always has been, and there always will be, because we live in a sinful world. But it's right before our eyes right now, Father. And we come to you in the name of Jesus and ask that you would calm things down according to your will in our country with those who are seeking to do harm to this nation, but from within or from outside of our country. There are many forces at work here, Heavenly Father. Some of them are good. Some of them are obviously evil. Lord, it's what a blessing it is to live in a country where we are free to protest injustice. And I pray, Lord, we join and we're in one accord in praying that those freedoms would be preserved, and that protests would be heard and that they would be effective and that we would talk with one another and love on one another. And most especially, Jesus, that we would listen to one another in order to understand where some of the differing opinions and ideas are coming from. Lord, stop dead in its tracks the enemy of racism and those who would foment racism among us. And Lord, some of the people who are screaming the loudest right now are not helping the situation. We pray, Lord God, that you would quiet those people who are not helping and that you would raise the voices of those who are helping the situation. Lord, we ask that you would guide and lead President Trump and Vice President Pence. You've told us in your word, Lord, that we are to pray for our government. And so we do, unashamedly, unabashedly. It has nothing to do with politics. It has to do, Lord Jesus, with your command, your exhortation to do so. And so we ask that you'd be with President Trump and Vice President Pence. We ask that you'd be with the with their staff. We ask that you would be with the president's cabinet. We ask that you would be with both houses of Congress. We ask that you would be with our state government. We ask that you would be with the county and parish governments, the governments of cities and towns and villages. We ask that you would be involved in our local communities, governments, Lord, and our mayors and our town managers and city managers and whatever might exist. And Father, there's a lot of people that we just mentioned that are in all of those positions. We ask that you would work in those people, whether they know you or not, that you would work in the hearts of those people and give them wisdom, give them knowledge, give them skill, set around them wise advisors that can speak into the situation so that for the best and highest good of every single person in this country, we can be led forward peaceably and quietly and in a mature manner and in a manner that befits this great country that we have and the privileges that you've enabled us to have in being free. So, Lord, all politics aside, please just stop anyone or any people from other countries or what have you who are trying to mess up what we have been given here in this country, who are trying to take away our freedom of speech, who are trying to take away our freedom of religion. And Lord, it's not about religion. We know it's about relationship. But Lord, there are those who would seek to do us harm. And so we pray you'd frustrate their efforts and that your truth, the truth of your word, would spread far and wide all through this land. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your church, Lord, especially the churches of our southern district. And we ask, Lord, that you would do a work that only you can do. We ask, Holy Spirit, that in your kindness, as you said in your word, you would lead us to repentance. Yes, Lord, in the church, lead us to repentance in the church, for we are not without guilt and stain and sin. There are many things that we have done and left undone that we need to seriously repent of. So bring spiritual awakening. Help us to see who you are, God. Help us to see what you're doing. Help us to be ready for the next step where you're going to take your church. Lord, it might look completely different than we're comfortable with. But Lord, help us to trust you and to get on board with whatever you are doing. We don't ask so much that you would bless what we're doing, but help us to do what you are blessing. Lord Jesus, bring spiritual awakening. Holy Spirit, bring about revival in the church, not just our churches, in the one holy Christian church, all across our states, all across this nation, even all across the world. Lord, help us, especially we kind of tradition-bound Lutherans, help us to be open to new ways of being the church. Help us to be open to new ways of discipleship as you are forcing us into these new ways because For many, church is not an option right now. Even if the church is open, we're restricted, Lord, or by number, or we're restricted where we can sit and what we can do. And many are just staying home because they're frail or infirm and they're fearful of catching the virus. So you are forcing us down new ways and new paths. Help us not to resist you, God, but to join you on the work in and on and with the work that you are doing. You are actively involved in this world. Your church will prevail no matter what. But Lord, we know that you've done it in the past, and you likely will do it again in the future. If Jesus is going to tarry in coming, the church might look different than it has for all of our lives. If that's what you're doing, Lord, prepare us, equip us to bring the gospel to bear. And Lord, help us just to be effective in however and whatever we do in word and sacrament ministry, to be the church in whatever ways you have us do that. And Lord, finally, we pray and we ask that you would keep us strong in your word. Lord, our life is found in your word. Jesus is the word made flesh. Keep us strong in reading your word. Help us to find the time, Lord, if that's something people struggle with. Give us your Holy Spirit that as we read it with eyes that are hungry and with souls and spirits that are hungry, and that we can figure out what it is saying and that we can figure out how to apply it to our lives. And then, Lord, give us your Holy Spirit and courage and power to be able to actually apply it to our lives, that we can become more and more conformed to the image of Jesus Christ through this wonderful sanctification gift that you are giving, that you have given to us. Father, it is a joy to be able to come to you in prayer. We are thankful for the means of technology and for those people who put it all together for us, that we can pray here and now. We know you have heard all of our prayers. You are already answering them. And with great joy, Lord, we thank you and we praise you. We worship you in the strong and victorious name of your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. In his name, amen. It's great to pray. It's great to go before the Father. And so I just want to briefly share a little bit of scripture with you to send you off from our Together We Pray session. And I want to take you back. And these are verses that are being used a lot these days. And I think it's a good thing, these verses. And I'm in the Old Testament in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And let me read a couple of verses here for you. And then we'll just say a few words. And we'll get ourselves sent off to the rest of the day. Beginning with verse 1. After this, the Moabites and Ammonites with some of the Meunites came to make war on Jehoshaphat, the king, right? Some men came and told Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming against you from Edom, from the other side of the sea. It is already in Hazazon Tamar, that is in Gedi. Verse 3. Alarmed, gee, wouldn't you be? I would. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, Yahweh, and he proclaimed a fast for all Judah. The people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. That's what we're doing. That's the whole purpose behind these Together We Pray sessions, is the people came together to seek help from the Lord. And remember the old liturgy, from TLH 1941? Our help is in the name of the Lord who made heaven and earth, we used to say and sing. So they gathered. And they inquired of the Lord, and they sought help from the Lord. Then verse 5, then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said, this is his speech, okay? This is his prayer. O Lord, Yahweh, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. O our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, if calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or the plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name, and you will cry out and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us. So isn't that just what we're doing? You know, whether it's calamity or judgment or plague or famine, that's what we're facing. And so we cry out to God. And then here's Jehoshaphat's prayer. He continues, but now, verse 10, but now here are men from Ammon, Moab, and Mount Seir, whose territory you would not allow Israel to invade when they came from Egypt. So they turned away from them and did not destroy them. See how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possessions you gave us as an inheritance. O our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. There it is. So they were facing this army coming to invade them. But the same thing is true. The same prayer is true, and that we pray too with this plague, with this virus, and with all the things that are happening right now in our country. And we say to God, we have no power to face this vast army that is attacking us. We have no power to face this virus. We have no power to ourselves face the anarchists and chaos that's going on with the looting and the violence and the bloodshed around our country. But we say the same prayer right here at the end of verse 12. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. That's the answer. Keeping our eyes on God. We do that by staying in the Word. We do that by singing praises. We do that by listening to Christian music, whether you like traditional or whether you like contemporary things like on K-Love or The Message or whatever station you like to listen to for that. It keeps our minds focused on where the power really is. We don't know what to do, God, but our eyes are upon you. I encourage you to read the rest of 2 Chronicles 20 because there's much, much good stuff in there. But I've gone on long enough here for us today. Brothers and sisters in Christ, if you are at that point where you're just kind of throwing your hands up, and even if you're not, and you're just kind of rolling with the punches every day, here's what it is. We recognize this is bigger than anything anybody can handle. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you, God. May your eyes be on him now, and quite frankly, forever. It's been a pleasure to be with you. May God bless you as you continue the journey day by day. In Jesus' name, amen.